Eric Underwood was pleased about that. Only a few more minutes to go, but he'll be quite happy to start off tomorrow morning, hopefully in better light with his skipper, Tony Greig, who incidentally is playing another magnificent inning. Some really beautiful drives there and shots off his pads to go with that century in the first innings. He's come back to form with a bang and he's exuding tremendous self-confidence out there, and that could have a great effect on the bottom half of the England innings. Very, very bad start there by England. They've been pulled together by Willie and Greig. Can they do it tomorrow? Well, in this test match, I wouldn't like to wager anything on the outcome. It's been such a fascinating and magnificent test. One of the greatest 4 days cricket I've ever seen in my life. And tomorrow, I think, will be a fitting finale. The odds, well, I'm sure at this moment, they must be even money. And I suppose only the Patriots of either side would consider that their team had a cast iron case. 114 runs needed by England on the final day of the Headingley Test match to pull off what would be a famous victory. It's been a marvellous cricket match so far, conditions perfect for the final day, not a cloud in the sky, and it was Michael Holding who began play by completing his unfinished over to Derek Underwood.
There'll be some tingling nerves out there this morning. Not only from the batsman, but also from the fieldsman. Derek Underwood survives that first delivery. Tony Greig facing Wayne Daniel. It's well bowled. Must take all the singles. There's no real chance to protect Derek Underwood, the night watchman. That's a pretty good delivery from Wayne Daniel. Came back a long way off the seam. By a coat of varnish. And that is out, caught behind. Derek Underwood waving the bat outside off stump. And the first wicket goes down. So that's the breakthrough for the West Indies. It's not the top batsman, Tony Greig. It's Derek Underwood. He's out without scoring. And it's 148 for six. Just a faint outside edge. No chance of Derek Murray missing that one. And this is the crucial moment for England. The centurions of the first innings come together now. Alan Knott coming out to join Tony Greig. This is the partnership that matters. So that's Tony Greig now to face Andy Roberts. Oh, beautifully fielded. Clive Lloyd. He covered a lot of ground there away to his right. There was a certain boundary had he not got his hands to it. Beautifully bowled. Wasn't at full pace. Beautifully controlled movement away from the bat. Tony Greig had to play at it. Daniel to Alan Knott. Knott is off the mark. No one throws the fieldsman. Two to Alan Knott, and 150 comes up. Half an appeal there from the players. Much more of an appeal from the crowd. But it was going right down the lakeside, I should think. were bowled, and it's out. What a good delivery that was, and that's the one that's won the match, unless Tony Gregg can do something really extraordinary. Alan Knott is out for two. Caught Murray bowled Daniel, and a magnificent delivery that was. The big leg cutter, and Derek Murray takes it. It was still on the way up, and he took it at shoulder height. Tom Spencer raises the finger, and Alan Knott is out. So it's 150 for seven, and Wayne Daniel has struck twice this morning. Once Underwood, once Knott. And now only Tony Gregg left with Snow, Ward and Willis. Called by umpire Spencer. Pick up two runs. Wayne Daniel still with the sleeveless sweater on. One throw. Pick up two for that. Fine shot for four. Good crisp stroke off the toes. Nothing flurried about it. Just nicely angled with the bat. That's out. That's a good catch too. A very good catch, and Daniel's done it again. What a great little session for Wayne Daniel, and no wonder they're pleased with him out there. That was a good delivery. John Snow had to play at it. Gordon Greenidge, the man taking the catch that dismissed John Snow. Alan Ward comes out now, so it'll be a matter of him sticking around now while Tony Gregg throws the bat. 101 still needed. And Andy Roberts the bowler. And that's down to third man. It's safe and it's four runs. That is just what Tony Gregg has to do. He's not going to get much in the slot to drive. He's going to have to make his own length. Yorker. Single to Gregg, he goes to 41. Not sure that was the wisest move to take at that stage of the over. Not a lip reader, but it looked as though it was something like, where did that go? And that's exactly where it went. About 9 inches on the right-hand side of the edge of the bat. Feel it by Viv Richards. The field spreads a bit now for Tony Gregg facing Wayne Daniel. The two gullies come out, the three on the offside, saving the runs, and two on the onside. Two slips. That's a good shot. Picked it up and hit it down to deep backward square leg. Picked up the line very quickly there and went with it. One, That's an equally good stroke over mid-wicket this time. He forced Clive Lloyd to make one or two fielding changes, I would think. Tony Greig goes to 49, and the total moves on now to 172 for 8. Take the single that time. Oh, and Greig's gone down. He's brought up his half century and taken a big tumble. 173 for 8, and Tony Greig is 50. It's 50 come up in 102 minutes, 8 fours. And now Alan Ward has to survive two balls from Wayne Daniel. First one negotiated safely. Well played by Alan Ward. So it's 173 for 8, Tony Greig on 50, Alan Ward hasn't scored, and Wayne Daniel now has 3 for 60.
And again, the field pushback now for Tony Greig, whose only chance here is to try and crack these pace bowlers. Difficult job for him, but one can only admire this innings again. 50 out of 173. Roberts coming into him. Great shot. My word, I don't think we've seen a better shot played in this match. Everything was there for him, overpitched outside the off stump. But my word, he didn't have to lay up that one. But really hit those boundary boards before a fielder had moved. Greig going through the single, and hesitation there by Ward. So he's safely home, and that just leaves Alan Ward with one ball to keep out, in the hope that Greig can carry on launching this attack then from the other end. Close catches, three slips, two gullies now for Alan Ward. Played that well. So Ward here giving valuable support to Tony Greig. They've had it 20 since he came in. He's not yet off the mark, but that's of no great consequence. Roberts 3 for 39, 82 more runs still wanted. Holding to Greig. Beautifully placed. Put it in with the extra slip. Flashed off the edge for four runs. And Tony Greig was not at all worried where that one went. So Well, since Tony Greig decided to launch this attack on the arrival of Ward, he's already hit 5 boundaries in the last 4 overs. On 59 now, holding the bowler. And he's taken it on the 4th. A single there. One, two, three slips. And Clive Lloyd going in to make the 4th. A squarish gully. I could really have left that alone, but unfair to criticise a number 10 batsman. One more to keep out. So he kept it out all right, survives another over, and another opportunity for Tony Greig. That's in the air, could be safe again. He has one bounce to Rodden's Rose, crept in a good deal closer at third, and I'm looking for the miscued shot there. Well, they took a single off that. Greig possibly initially thinking he might have got 2. And back come the slips again. Roberts to Ward. Two more to face. I'm sure this crowd here at Headingley are counting with Alan Ward. Oh, what's Tony Greig doing? Halfway down the wicket there. That's in a very old-fashioned look from Alan Ward.
Anyway, everything running for Tony Greig here.
Well, that's a handy delivery. Bounced like a tennis ball. Four wide, so no need at all for Tony Greig to worry about that. Extremely short. Cleared Tony Greig 6'7" height there by 3 or 4 feet. The shortest bounce we've seen in the series. So the 7th over, bowled this morning by Roberts from the Kirkstall Lane end. Straight to Fredericks, they won't get more than 1, so Ward this time has left with 5. That could be a little ominous. That's a nasty delivery. Did pretty well there not to get a touch. Well, he survived 5 this time. That's no mean performance. ...69 runs still required. And Clive Lloyd is turning now to Van Bernholder. He got the wicket of Bob Woolmer. That's in the air and safe for 4. And there again, rather surprising that he hasn't pushed that man a little deeper. Just clearing his head. And now he's pushing him back in the place where the ball bounced. That could go through for another 4. Touch and go. Nice bit of work in the outfield. Just 2 runs there to Greig. Greenidge doing the fielding out there. First time he's been away from the slips in this match. A score now on 199. Greg on 72. In the air, but safe. Greenwich again busy out there. So he gets two more. And for the second time, the scoreboard moves round to 199. And added too many on the last time. Now he should be looking for the single. That's it. Sensible piece of cricket there by the England captain. Brings up the 200. One ball left for Alan Ward to face. Really enjoyed that. Lesser pace than some of the others he's faced. Well pitched up ball. Single this time, avoid deep at mid-off. West Indies in no hurry. Gently walking back into the close catching position. Two balls left in this over. Is that it? Yes, he's on his way. He's walking without looking at the umpire. So this fine partnership broken at last. But full marks to Alan Ward. They've put on 46 runs. 40 of them by Greg. Six extras. Alan Ward hasn't opened his account, but has rendered valuable service there. Alan Ward, the ninth man out for England, the score on 204, 56 more runs required. And Alan Ward getting a good hand for some heroic resistance there. Just couldn't resist flicking there at that wide one and offering Murray his third catch of the morning. 47 minutes they were together, and if Bob Willis can do a similar job, England would be very close to this 260 target they require. Just one ball left in this over. And he's out LBW to a full toss, first ball, it's all over. West Indies triumphant, grabbing the stumps, the souvenirs for them. Because that means they've won this series, and they've won it by a margin of 55 runs. So the end of really one of the greatest test matches we've seen for many, many years. And Tony Greig, the man who defied them to the end, carrying his bat in the second innings, undefeated for 76. A truly magnificent effort from Tony Greig, adding to his superlative 100 here in the first innings.
Thank you very much indeed, Tony. Well, the crowd have been very patient. They're all standing around the pavilion and they've been quiet for a moment. Clive Lloyd, really a magnificent test match and a fine West Indies performance.
Yeah, I thought we played extremely well. And I must full marks to my players, especially the batsmen, and more so the bowlers that were injured who persisted and despite their injury, and they did a fine job for us. I think England played extremely well. They gave us a run for our money. Tony played a marvellous, two marvellous innings. It's a pity that he's in the losing side, but can't take it away from me. He had a very good game, and it's obvious that we are quite happy that we have won, but more so that the people have enjoyed the cricket.
How will this affect your attitude towards the fifth and final test now that you're two up in the series?
I don't think it would affect us that much in the sense that we just want to win and win as much as we can. But I think it could be a very good spectacle, and I hope a lot of people do turn up.
When you started the day with England just needing 114, did you feel that you had to make an early breakthrough to win this match?
Yes, it's obvious that once we got that initial breakthrough, when we got Alan Knott out and Underwood, we thought we had a chance, because we knew then that with the fellas to come, Tony would have had to take things into his hands and we'd have had to throw the bat as he did. And somewhere along the line, I'm sure that, you know, we probably would have done it. And Michael just produced one of those balls that, you know, and got the vital wicket, and that was it.
Mm-hmm. Well, Clive, the crowd have been very patient. I know they're waiting to give you a big cheer. Many thanks indeed for talking to us, and congratulations again.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Cheers. Tony. Well, Tony, a really wonderful performance by yourself, but you must be a little disappointed about this morning's play.
Yes, very disappointed. Obviously, we had a chance this morning, but I wouldn't want to take anything away from the way the West Indians played. I think that they set the pace for this match on the first day, where they got 450 runs in a day, which is a tremendous effort. And the crowd that saw that will probably never forget it. And I think perhaps it was that 450 that at the end of the day, perhaps was the thing that sorted us out. We weren't ever quite there.
How did you sleep last night?
Oh, very well, very well. My wife promised me she'd come up if I got 100 in the first innings, which I did, so she came all the way to Leeds, and I slept very well, yes.
When you set out this morning, what sort of instructions had you given to the batsmen that were to follow you?
We just had to play normally, that was mine, so I don't believe too much in trying to tell other people how to play, especially people like Notty, who's played a lot of test cricket and more than I have, and who's been very successful. We went out there and played the way we knew how, and obviously I played a little bit differently towards the end. But again, I wouldn't want to take any credit away from the West Indies for the way they bowled. As Clive Lloyd said, they had one or two bowlers who had little niggles, and they bowled through them. They had to, because they were under pressure if they didn't, and they did their job very well and won the match, and that's really what matters, so good luck to them.
Tony, good luck to you when you play at the Oval in about 2 weeks' time. A really fine performance by an England side that many people had written off even before it started.
Well, it's nice, it's always nice, rewarding to make a fight back, and I think we did fight back well in this match. As I've said before, we're not a great side, but we are a bunch of fighters, and we're playing against a fine cricket side, and so I think in view of those statements, then our performance wasn't too bad.
Well, few people will disagree with Tony Gregg when he says that the West Indians have been the better side in this series. There's been some magnificent cricket, but I suppose the clincher has been the three fast bowlers in the West Indian side. If you have two great fast bowlers, then that's pretty good as far as the captain's concerned. If you have three, then it's a tremendous bonus. And Roberts, Holding and Daniel certainly bowled extremely well throughout the four games played so far. This is one of the finest games of cricket I've ever seen. I suppose the tight test match in Brisbane in 1960 and then the Manchester Test 61 and perhaps the Lord's Test in 56 would be the three top-ranking ones in my mind, and I certainly put this one in the top five of games in which I either played or watched. A tremendous game of cricket, played in a very good spirit, and some really marvellous performances. Well, England go to the Oval now and they can continue this comeback trail that they started in this game. At one point, with the West Indies 437 for 9 and England 32 for 3, things were as desperate as they possibly could be. And I think from that point on, we saw a really gritty piece of cricket from Tony Gregg and his England side. And if they can keep that going, and if they can produce another couple of young players like Peter Willey for the Oval Test and then for the Australians next year, everything will have been worthwhile. But this game, a marvellous game of cricket, won by the better team.